here this morning. As I was telling the Sunday school class, it's summer. And we're getting real close to school, so people are trying to get in that last second trip or shopping trip, whatever they have to do. So we have some gone today. Just keep them in your prayers. Keep Brother Ray in your prayers. He's not feeling great this morning. And so just keep him in your prayers and know that God will take care of him. I don't know for you, but it's been a hot and busy week. And this next one's going to be more so of both. So I'm going to just encourage you. Remember how it feels in December when you're freezing. Oftentimes, I forget that in December I say things like, I sure wish it was July or it would warm up. And it could be worse. We could be in Brazil. It's winter in Brazil. They're freezing to death in 80 degree temperatures. 70 degree. Oh, it's getting bad this year. Cold weather. So all I can tell you is you don't want to go to Brazil when it's summer for them. Because it's a little warm. We're really glad you're here this morning. Let's all stand together. One of my favorite sets of music is it talks about heaven. I don't know about you, but I'm looking forward to that day that everything that I go through every day is over and I'm with the Lord. Lord, we thank you this morning that we can come and worship you. Be with those that aren't here today. Those that are sick, Lord, just touch them. Lord, keep everyone safe as they travel. Lord, we pray for the service today that we would focus on you. That we would remember that you are there as holding on to us, even in the toughest days. Lord, I pray that we would just sing out to you and not worry about anything else. May all our burdens now. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. Lord, we all need you more. We thank you for being there for us, Lord. We ask you to be with those who are not here today, Lord, whatever they are, Lord, we just pray they come back and that they travel safely, Lord. Lord, we pray for those who are sick. Just lift them up to you. Lord, we look forward to hearing your word today. We just need to hide it in our heart, Lord, that we can use it in our daily life. Lord, just be with the offering today. Let it be sufficed, Lord. And we thank you for the privilege of serving you. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Since he was Lord, I pray that we would never forget. near for us. We'd be mindful of that. Lord, be with the message today that it would just touch our lives and that it would change us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As we continue our series, 2 Corinthians, I've thought about this summer so far. We've done a lot of travel this summer. Went all the way out to Missouri for the wedding, took our time coming back. We've had several trips, a lot of them are little trips, but they all have one thing in common. We know where we're going. Now, in my younger days, I really liked to just throw in the fishing poles and the tackle box and just go somewhere. And I never found a good fishing spot because I was too busy looking for it instead of fishing. And what I found out was if I didn't have a specific place I was going, I would wander around and not be very successful. Through the years, Dad and I have been hunting together many times. And what we've learned is if I don't have a plan, we just drive around in the country for no reason. When you know what your destination is, you have a path to get there, don't you? You find a route. Nowadays, it's real simple. Nowadays, you Google it. And it gives you a map, unless your dad, and probably David, and probably Ray, well, I don't know about Ray, he uses technology or something.
No, I use the map.
Use a map. My dad still pulls out his map. So Karen does something when we're on longer trips, and she pulls out the atlas. Remember that thing? I mean, it should just say antique on it somewhere, and you know, when she goes and buys one, I know they get excited because it's been sitting there for 25 years before someone finally bought it. And so sometimes I think they even think about this here, just take it. Didn't know anyone use this anymore. But she'll get on there and she'll know exactly where we're at. That always turns out well for me. Life is the same way. If you don't know where you're going, you're never going to get there.
That's right.
What is it that you want to do in life? Where are you trying to go? What is your destination? And Christians, for us, what is your destination? If your destination is here on earth, you're in trouble. Because you haven't understood the truths of the Bible. My destination is not Missouri. While it was good, my destination is heaven. And in my life, if that's not my destination, I'm in trouble. And I should be knowing how to get to heaven. You go, well, everybody knows it. No, they don't. In fact, most people, unfortunately, do not know how to get to heaven. They think you get to heaven by being nice. They think you get to heaven by showing up to church. They think you get to heaven by helping people who are homeless or sick or those things. None of those ways will get you to heaven. There's only one way to heaven, and His name is Jesus. We should never, ever, ever stop preaching that gospel. We should never stop talking about the destination is heaven. And you only get there through Jesus. You can't do it through me. You can't do it through Ray. person on this earth, only Jesus. This morning, we're going to look at what Paul says we know. If you don't know these things this morning, you should. And I pray that you take notes. I pray that you listen. I pray that you do something to remember what we talk about. You know, we've been talking about youth ministry and all those things. There's a lot happening that you don't know about yet. A lot. And it's a really beautiful thing. And I've been praying about it. I've said, Lord, whatever we do, it's got to be for your glory. Whatever we do, Lord, it's got to lead people to Jesus. Whether a kid or a youth or an adult, it doesn't matter. We need to be leading people to Jesus so that their destination is the same place I'm going when I die, which is heaven. In verse 1, it starts with simply the word for, F-O-R, not the number, but F-O-R. It links us to something that we had read in the chapter before. And so I want to read a few verses from the chapter before because it's important. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, it says, therefore we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. Right? So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. That links us to the verse, chapter 5, verse 1. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Paul's going to tell us in this passage, and begins to tell us in this passage, what we know. The first thing that I know what will happen to me when I die. I know what will happen to me when I die. Can you say that same thing? You didn't sound very convincing. Can you say the same thing? I know what's going to happen to me when I die.
Yes.
If you can't say yes today, I pray that you really listen. Because you may not have this afternoon. You may not have passed this parking lot today. You know, we're rehearsing like we do every single Sunday morning. I'm looking at Ray, he's looking at me like we do every Sunday morning and Wednesday night. And all of a sudden, Ray puts his guitar down and he's out. It caught my attention enough that I had to stop the song because I really messed it up. And I said, well, I hope he's okay. And we continued to sing. We got to the last song. And where's Ray? I went to find him. He wasn't feeling well. He went home and did some medicine to help himself feel better. I'm glad it wasn't anything super serious. He is going to have to go to the doctor. I know he likes going as much as I do. But he's going to have to go get that checked out. And he may find out that he just ate one too many burritos. Or he may find out some news that he didn't want to hear. We don't know those things. But what I know is, if something happened to Brother Ray, and this was his last day here, I'm going to see him in heaven one day.
Amen.
I am encouraged by that. I will miss him like crazy. He's supposed to outlive me, because I've already given him the plans of my funeral of what not is going to happen. And I know y'all aren't listening, but he may be short, but he can be pretty tough, too. I was telling the class this morning, any man that can do the funeral service of his wife, can only do that through the power of God. Let me tell you, you can't do those things on your own. When we were gone, Ray kind of had the whole thing going, and I said to Ray, I sure appreciate everything you did, and Ray made a great comment. He said, without other people, this is not possible. This is not the Ray Show. This is about people serving God, and he's right. What will happen to you when you die? It says here, from the tent maker himself, because that's what Paul did to earn money. He was not on the payroll in the church of Corinth. I figured out something. My wife had to really help me, and Clara had to help me. Wednesday night, Clara talked about what a blessing Bel Air is. What a blessing it is to have Christian brothers and sisters who check on each other, and they're always there for each other, and they encourage each other as often as they can. What a real blessing. It is a blessing, isn't it? It's a real blessing that we have that. And then it hit me. And Karen said it out loud, but it hit me. Even if I'm not here after today, and I don't plan on going anywhere, by the way, but if I'm not, Bel Air Baptist will still move forward. My concern has never been about what people think about me. My concern has never been about getting famous or rich or those things. My concern for Bel Air is, will we keep ministering to other people even if key people weren't here? I believe we will. That's the most encouraging thing that I can say this morning. Because I got to tell you, this tent right here that's getting big, let's talk about the big top tent, right? I'm getting there. I'm kind of the big top tent at this point. I used to look like a little teepee, and now something happened. I'm the big top tent, but this thing is breaking down. I got scars. I'm telling you, last couple of days, I've had the weirdest, most painful headaches I think I've ever had. To a point that I didn't even let my wife drive. Let me tell you, that's a big deal. But she says, should I drive? And I pull over and say, yes. You know I'm not feeling very well. This is breaking down. You know, there's many people in here that's had surgery lately, right? Some of you have hips that are leaking metal into your body, like armrests you had to have more surgery. We have people that aren't here today because they have important doctor visits. We have people like Marty, who's just, her health is struggling. She's having to take test after test after test. Our bodies break down. These were not ever meant to last forever. Amen? I'm glad. Because if I got to heaven and then I got to keep this one, no. I don't want this one. I want the one that has no pain, the one that has no scars, the one that has no disappointments, the one that has no hurts. That's the body I want. I want a perfect body. One of these days, when I'm not here anymore, and I'm in heaven, then the rapture happens, I'm going to come up from Bel Air Baptist toilet, because I kept saying I'm going to flush all of y'all, and so I know what you're going to do to me. That's fine. I don't care what you do to this, because it's going to be raptured up to meet Jesus in the air. And I'm going to get a body that is perfect. In heaven, there will only be one body that has scars, and that's the one who made it possible for us to go to heaven, which is Jesus. It will have the scars in his hands and the scars in his feet, where he died for us. The Son of God that created us, he was there in the beginning, let us create. He was there in the beginning. The Son of God came to this earth so that he could die for us. Don't sound very fair that he's the one that has scars and I'm going to get a perfect brain and body. But I don't want what is fair. I want what God has given us in grace and mercy.
Amen.
In John chapter 14, verse 1, it says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have not told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be with me where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going." The second thing that I know is that I have a mansion in heaven. You go, where did you get the word mansion? Now, a lot of times they don't use the King James Version. And to be honest with you, it's because we don't talk that way. We start doing the these and thous and all that. And half those words, I don't know. I'm just going to put it on me. I use the NIV. I use different translations of Scripture. But in the King James Version, it says, "My Father's," let me just read it again. In the NIV, it says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." Where it says, "My Father's house has many rooms," in the King James, it says, "In my Father's house are many mansions." I'd rather have a mansion than just a room. Amen? That's a little greedy. I know. That's greedy. That's the flesh talking a little bit there. You know, I had a person that came to Bel Air a long time. And this person had heard an evangelist when she was pretty young. And the evangelist said something that I wish whoever he was, he would not have said what he did. Because he said that where you live in heaven is based on how you live in earth. So, if that's the case, I'm getting an outhouse. That's about all I've done. Sorry. No, that's not what I was thinking. And I said to that person, you either make it to heaven or you don't. Why would God promise me a mansion and not give it to me? Has God ever failed you one time? Has God's any promises that God has given you, have they not happened? No, God's faithful to fulfill his promise, right? So there are many in heaven, there will be many mansions. Even for some of us like Kevin and I, they don't really have it coming. You know why? Because Kevin and I are going to have perfect bodies. We're going to have perfect bodies. And we're going to have mansions. By the way, there's not marriage in heaven. I'm not going to get in too much trouble. But mansions. Do you know how many people living on this earth today dream of living in a mansion? In fact, they'll give up everything they can to get enough money to build a mansion. And you know that mansion may be really nice here on earth, but will it satisfy all your needs?
No.
Do we even need a mansion in heaven? Not really. I mean, we're going to be walking on streets of gold. We're going to be walking by gates that have jewels in them that people will sacrifice their own life on this earth to get. And it's just ordinary, not important things in heaven. We have a mansion. Verse 2. "Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed instead of with our heavenly dwelling, because what we are clothed, it will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life." The third thing I know is I know that I would get tired
of my earthly body. My pastor friend, Oliver Hill, his mother is not well. His son, Oliver's son, works at the warehouse with me, the student worker. And so I get to ask him, because this is Russell Hill's wife. Russell Hill is one of my best friends. He's already in heaven. And he said, you know, he calls me pastor, or he said, Pastor, you know, my grandma's ready to go home. She's tired of fighting sickness and all this. She's tired. She's just ready to go home. She's ready to see my grandpa and even more. She's ready to see Jesus face to face. Man, I've been a lot of funeral services through the years. And some of those, while I stood here and cried, it was tears of joy because that person we watched them suffer. There's nothing worse than watching a loved one suffer, is it? It's terrible. It's awful. And I stood here and cried while I preached their funeral, and I used these verses. And I thought, there's going to be a day when I'm just tired. You have no idea how many doctors I've been to. Every time I go to a doctor, it gets into another doctor and takes some tests, and gets sent another guy to take some tests, and this one, and this one. And they all say the same thing. We don't know what to do. And there's days that I told Karen, you know what? I've seen my last doctor. I'm not taking any stupid medication. I'm not going to go anymore. I'm just going to do what I want to do. And what happens will happen. A lot of you understand what I'm saying, don't you? Because you've been there. Maybe you're there right now. I get tired of pain. God is faithful every Sunday morning. I get here some days late, like today. I know Ernie was getting a little worried. We were about 25 minutes later than normal. It kind of looked like a trend this morning. We all took a little longer to get here than what we usually do. Let me tell you, as long as you're here, keep pushing. Keep going. Because it won't be long and you'll get to rest. Even if it's another 50 years, compared to eternity, it's not long. Verse 5. Now the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit guaranteeing what is to come. I know that my eternity in heaven has been guaranteed. I know y'all never see me jump up and down, probably get scared if I did, but that ought to excite you this morning that no one can cancel your salvation. No one can cancel your trip to heaven. If you're saved, you are saved. And you have been sealed with the power of the Holy Spirit, and He has guaranteed that one day you will spend your life in heaven. Amen? It's a guarantee. You know, there's not much guarantees in this world, is there? There's not much. When they guarantee your car for 10 years, I guarantee you that it's going to break down in 10 years one day. Yeah. Right? I guarantee you that. That's what happens every time. I guarantee you that you'll get your money back if you don't like the product. I guarantee you you're wrong. They'll make you wait so long for your $49.99 back that you're never going to get it. I've had people guarantee
guarantee me that when they come in, we don't know them, they ask for money, and I give them money, and they guarantee me that they're going to bring that money back. Yeah, I guarantee you they ain't. But God has said, I guarantee you, through the Holy Spirit, that you will one day enter into heaven. That's good. That ought to get you excited. That should remind you why we do what we do. We should want every person we know to have that same guarantee. Amen?
Amen.
We should want every person we know to have that same guarantee. In verse 6, therefore we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith and not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please Him, whether we are at home in the body or away from Him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. The last thing that I know this morning, I know that I can be confident in my faith. I can be confident in my faith. As long as I'm in this body, I'm not in heaven. But the moment I die, this body will just be a shell. It'll just be a tent. One of the things I had to do as a fire chaplain, which is really tough, was I had to be there when people die. We get called almost every time. These people did not have a pastor. They weren't Christians. They were very distraught. And I would go in there. And one time, and Leon was the head chaplain, fire chaplain at the time, and Elio and I was helping him. And I got a call, and I went to walk in, like I always did, and one of the detectives ran over to get me, but I got in the house before they did. And let me tell you, it was the most horrid smell I've ever smelled in my life. It made me sick. I got sick out in the front yard of this house. What had happened is this elderly lady died in the bathtub, and she had been there for 5 days. Let me tell you, you can ask over here at the morgue, you can ask anywhere you want, that when you die, this body goes quick. This tent, this flesh, goes quick because there's not blood pumping through it anymore. And it will rot and smell horrid very quickly. You go, well, that's what I wanted to hear before lunchtime. I am confident that when I take my last breath, that I'll be in heaven. Until then, I need to walk by faith, not by sight. It is hard to walk by faith, amen? It's hard. It's not easy to walk by faith. But you're to walk by faith. That means even when it doesn't make sense, you need to do it anyhow. You walk by faith, not by sight. In the end, we're all going to be judged. I'm not judging. David is not judging. God will judge. And it says whether it's good or bad, it's going to be dealt with. For the person that does not know Jesus as Savior, they will be at the great white throne judgment. And they will be judged according to their works. And the Bible says in Revelation that there'll be books with all the things that they did wrong, all the sins. There'll be all these sins listed in the book. And everything they've done will be read before all these people. And then they'll be cast into the lake of fire. The lake of fire was only meant for the devil and the fallen angels. But they'll be cast in the lake of fire because they do not know Jesus as Savior. There will be a day that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess Jesus Christ as Lord. Amen. Will you do it while you're here, or will you have to wait till you're in heaven and then be judged according to your works? For me as a Christian, you know how I'm going to be judged? Through the refiner's fire. I'm going to go through this really, really tough situation, I guess you could say, and everything in my life that was for God will last. Everything I did that wasn't for God will be burned up. And it says that some people will just make it into heaven as by fire. Now, this isn't a biblical illustration. It's just one that hits my mind every time I say this. It's almost as if that person's walking into heaven with smoke back here. They did nothing to show who they serve. I don't know about you, but I want to hear, well done. Well done, my good and faithful servant, enter into your reward. That's what I want to hear. I don't want to be the guy that just made you barely as by fire, and no one ever even knew who I served. That's not what I want. I want to hear, well done. You're not going to hear, well done, if you're not doing anything for the Lord. And even if you're doing things for the Lord, but you're doing it to make you feel good about yourself, it won't last. Your motive's got to be love. Your motive's got to be about doing things for the Lord. If you're doing it for yourself, it's going to burn. This morning, you get a choice. As you get every single day, you get a choice. Are you going to make it to heaven? And if so, are you going to hear, well done? Or are you just going to barely make it? I know so many people that are playing what I call Russian roulette with their salvation. Don't ever play the game, by the way. But you've heard of it. You put a bullet in the chamber, you spin it, and it's pretty obvious how you lose this game. You pull the trigger. And if you don't shoot yourself in the head, then the next person goes. And there are so many people on this earth that are treating their salvation that way. They're just not sure. And they're thinking, it won't matter, I'll fix it tomorrow. Well, you may not get it tomorrow.
That's true.
You need to fix it today. Who do you serve? I want you to stand with me as we have a time of invitation this morning. As always, the altar is there for you. As always, we'll be glad to pray with you. Be faithful.